Page 4.
Yeah.
This relates to constitution amendments, concurrent resolutions. And you may recall that sometime in the last session, we had a situation where a constitutional amendment failed to get the necessary three-fifths majority, but got more than a majority. And as a result, we couldn't do anything with it because we couldn't get the necessary votes to pass it. We couldn't get the necessary votes to table it because it required a supermajority. So this would change the rules with respect to a motion to lay on the table of a constitutional amendment. And it would require simply a majority vote. So we can, if we fail to pass any constitutional amendment by the three-fifths majority, it then could be tabled and we could dispose of it in that way.
Any comments? Any phone calls?
Whose phone is that?
Go ahead with that one.
Okay, thank you.
That's a jail of that influence. Are you sure?
Let's see if you're working.
You're in commerce.
Let's use like
$5.
Seeing no comments, is there a motion to tentatively adopt that section? Representative Weber moves the adoption. Representative Greeley second. All those in favor of the motion of that section, please raise your hand. Aye. Those opposed? May the record reflect the vote.
I fully will expect to pay in the fine. It's appropriate, so you just let me know.
Put a fine in the rules?
Terms and Chairman, just having you here, it's priceless, so.
Fine enough.
We'll follow you then. Next section, Representative.
Okay, thank you. If you'll turn to page 6, as you all are aware, the proposal is to remove two committees that were formed for the first time 2 years ago. And on page 6, the proposal is to delete the Constitutional Review and Statutory Codification Committee. And if you turn to the next page, 7, to delete the Redress of Grievances Committee. Just so while we're all talking about that subject, that involves also deleting the duties of those two committees, which appear in paragraph C on page 7, and paragraph Q on page 10. So the proposal is to delete the Constitutional Review and Statutory Codification Committee and the Redress of Grievance Committee, and of course that involves deleting their duties.
Thank you. Just briefly, I'll let you know what our concern on this is and why we will be not be able to support this. We understand that perhaps these committees may have had undertaken too many things last year. I don't know if that's the best way to describe that or not. Our concern is by just doing away with them, then there's no avenue to deal with these because we haven't seen any options. I know. I had spoken with the speaker earlier about maybe a couple of options on things of how we could deal with some of these issues. So I think that's our concern. We now have gone from one place back to zero. And I was hopeful that we'd be somewhere, I don't know if it'd be a dribble, but at least somewhere upwards of zero to be able to deal with these issues should they come up. And were dealt with the speaker and or others the House felt were appropriate to have dealt with in a manner other than just printing. That's all. So.
I've seconded Representative Chandler's thoughts. I'll speak directly to constitutional review at this point. And if we remove this committee, which was certainly it did have its place, and I think it took the place of us as a general court thinking that we needed to refer bills over to judiciary to see if they were constitutional or not. This committee did serve a purpose for us. Would there be an opportunity to put a special committee in place should the opportunity arise that we need to look at the constitutionality of the bill.
Mr. Chairman, I think the speaker already has the authority to appoint special committees as needed, so I think there is an avenue here. As a former member of that committee, I really think that there are other ways to deal with constitutional review other than that committee, and perhaps better ways to deal with it.
Representative Chandler.
And we may not necessarily disagree with that, but we haven't had any option presented where it might be dealt with differently. I guess that's what we're saying.
Well, I just, I don't know if it does any good to debate it, but
no.
I think the Judiciary Committee has a number of lawyers on the committee, and they certainly deal with constitutional issues, and I think that's a better way. And in those rare cases where the Judiciary Committee doesn't feel it can handle it, there's House Counsel, and there's other ways to get legal advice that perhaps are a better way to do it than a committee that quite frankly, did not have a lot of legal training and didn't really do a lot of in-depth analysis of constitutional law.
Any other comments? Is there a motion regarding this section of the proposed rules?
The state section is the redress of grievances in section C and then section Q.
And the reference to redress grievances, constitutional reviews, and the two paragraphs C and Q to deal with the fees.
Right. Is there a second to that motion? Any comment before the vote's taken?
Oh, is this also on redress as well?
The proposal divide, yeah.
Yes, I don't have any comments. Sorry, redress. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Section 1, Article 31 of our Constitution states that the legislature shall assemble for redress of public grievances. And when you look at that, they do have to have a type of recourse. And redress is for those who do not have the financial wherewithal to go back to court and fight again. This is an opportunity for their concerns of how government may have offended them. And get some type of redress. If it means that we have to change the laws, which in fact, that maybe this committee did find cases where we did, in fact, had to fix some of our laws. This is a committee that would help us find those problems. And when we think about redress, where will the recourse going to be if we take away this constitutional right from them?
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Nice that you got an applause.
In answer to that, I would say that one of the things we found during the last 2 years, and one of the things that was acknowledged in one of the last meetings of the Rules Committee, on which I sat as a substitute, is that when we talk about the redress of grievances, we acknowledged, all of us, that we as a legislature do not have the power to write, to redo individual grievances against court decisions or agency decisions. What the purpose of redress of grievances has come to mean over the years is that corrective actions need to be taken when we find that there is a law or an agency action or something that is not working properly, and that the place to submit the fix is to the policy committee that has governance over that particular policy area. To do otherwise seems to me to be bad policy, but on an individual level, unspeakably cruel to people who come to the legislature thinking that their individual problem is going to be overturned or overridden by this legislature, and who then find that that's not what's going to happen.
Further comments, Representative Tucker.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And Representative Rubin, you're very correct in the fact that the purpose is to find out where the problem is. If we, in fact, remove redress of grievances, how are we going to find out where those problems are? to take the corrective action.
Representative Weber.
I find out what the problems are by listening to my constituents and deciding whether a bill is needed, and there are 400 of us to listen to our constituents, and you only have to persuade one of them to file a bill.
Any further comments? Representative Tucker and Representative Jasper afterward.
Thank you very much. I think one of the biggest advantages that we saw with redress of grievances was that we saw in certain cases that there was a continual problem, and that only would have came about with the institution of redress of grievances. Because one case with one over here, and then another case over here, and another case over here, they were all individual. However, when you put them all together, we saw that there was a bigger problem. And that way it can be addressed, and it's not just an individual piece of legislation affecting one. It's one that we see is bigger and affecting all.
Is it Jasper?
I'm not going to repeat Representative Tucker's comments. I will agree with her in, for the most part, and not take any exceptions to what she said. Mine is more a technical comment. As I read this, and maybe I'm being overly technical, but as I looked at the proposed rules and heard the motion, it would appear that our rules would then be numbered or lettered in this case, so the Q would be blank and R would continue, and I would suspect the intent would be to renumber all after P. And if we could just agree, then I don't think a motion is necessary.
No, that's a good point.
That is the intent, Representative Jasper. Thank you.
Thank you. Point that out. Any further comments? Seeing none, those in favor of the motions pending, raise the hand. Those opposed, may the record reflect that the motion passed on a vote of 6-2.
All right, Mr. Chairman, thank you. The next change is on page 9. Under existing rules, the rules call for for the legislative administration committee, have three subcommittees having to do with elections, mileage, and enrolled bills. And it's my understanding that those subcommittees have not been formed in a number of years. And so really this is, I think, a housekeeping matter where we're simply eliminating them as official categories or subcommittees. If it's necessary to create these subcommittees again, they can be created. I mean, there is leeway in the rule to allow that to happen, but it's a housekeeping matter. We just didn't think it made any sense to have these subcommittees that, in fact, were appointed and weren't
Yeah, they've still got the third part. Oh, really?
So my assumption is, given the duties within the Committee on Legislative Administration, if during the process there were problems found in enrolling, the report would just simply come back to the legislature from the Committee on Legislative Administration, much as we maybe pretend to do it now if something's found in the process. Is that,
yes,
is that the intent?
That's correct.
Representative Weber, the representative.
As a past chair of legislative administration, it was several people had that particular task to do the work, and they got together, it got done. If we had a problem on mileage, it was often resolved by a committee member speaking quietly to somebody and the problem was fixed. If there is, and the election problem that came up was decided by the committee as a whole. So I think the committee chair has the authority to appoint whatever subcommittees are necessary, and the committee retains the overall responsibility for reporting to the House on all agreements.
Thank you.
I go back a little farther when legislative administration was a secondary committee, and you were assigned to, as a secondary committee, is the one who wrote the third part, and I recall on the third part of the enrolled bills that it was a combination of the Secretary of State's office and legislative services to re-review the bill and go over it, and we would read it, but it was nothing formal, and signed off.
Any further comments? Seeing none, is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
The motion is pending. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. Now it's official. Opposed, seeing none, the motion, the record reflected, the motion carried 10-0.
All right, the next change, Mr. Chairman, is on page 23. And the only change here is that we've added a provision with respect to unanimous consent and a reference to Mason's rules that deal with unanimous consent, and we've added the reference to Mason's rules with respect to personal privilege. And there's always been some confusion as to what's unanimous consent and what's personal privilege, and just was thought to be helpful to have a reference to the section of Mason's where these are talked about. So that's, I think, a housekeeping issue.
Representative Jasper.
I'm wondering, probably the clerk would be the most appropriate person to answer that. Would it be possible just to get an overview of what these sections of Mason state?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. 220 talks about what's a question of privilege, what's a question of what's a privilege of the House, and what is personal privilege and what is not personal privilege. And it's very specific, and you've heard me say it over and over again. That one, I think, is very, very good. The unanimous consent on section 537. I thought that question might come up. The unanimous consent section in Mason's basically is talking about what we often use as without objection. And I think if I'm understanding this, and I'm sorry, Representative Richardson, I probably should have talked with you about this before. The closest thing I see is just when there appears to be no opposition and that you can't take it away afterwards. You want pages 374, 375, Representative Jasper, if you've got that.
Yes.
Book. But I think most of the unanimous consent section talks about what we use as without objection. We're going to do this because it talks about the body taking action by unanimous consent. When we use unanimous consent on the floor, we mean a member is requesting the unanimous consent of the House to speak on some topic or other. I know Congress uses that, and I don't know what their differential definition might be. I think this is as good as any.
Representative Richardson.
Thank you. Representative Jasper, I think that you might want to look at on page 374, paragraph 1, talks about a request for unanimous consent and simply says that the request should be stated precisely and clearly. I think the reference there would mean that when somebody wanted to invoke unanimous consent, they would simply state the reason, Madam Speaker, I would like to request unanimous consent to talk about X. And then without objection, the member would speak about topic X. But it would just give some warning to the House as to what the subject matter of the unanimous consent is. As you know, sometimes somebody will stand up and invoke unanimous consent, and the House has absolutely no idea what the member's going to be talking about.
Any further comments? Representative Jaster.
Yes, I think this is somewhat confusing because it does talk about suspension of the rules, which is not the way we have meant it. I'm not sure that this clarifies anything for us, and perhaps this part of it really is confusing. I suppose it still does leave a question of personal privilege for someone, but certainly when I read this whole section, it raises more questions than it answers. I'm not prepared to vote for this in this particular time, so I will have to vote against it until I can look at this along with personal privilege.
Representative Jasper, I don't think it means we need to suspend rules. It simply the section says that this has the same effect as suspending the rules, but basically a member would ask for unanimous consent to talk about whatever it is they want to talk about, and then if there's no objection, the member would be allowed to talk.
Any further comments? Is there a motion on this section?
So moved.
Second.
Any comments on the motion? Seeing that those in favor, please raise their right hand. Those opposed? May the record reflect the motion carried on a vote of 6-2-4.
Mr. Chairman, I just have a question on a previous rule before I vote down. It's on page 19, number 46.
Yeah.
The last statement of this says the chairman may decline the referral, and this, of course, has been in the rules for quite some time. And I just want clarification as to which chair, perhaps the clerk can answer that question. Is it the first chair can decline or the second chair?
Where are you? In which section?
Page 46, the very first, the bills appropriating.
Mm-hmm.
The very last piece of that is chairman may decline bill referral. And my question is what has been the process of who is the chair that would decline? Would that be the first chair or the second chair?
Page 20, I think.
19.
Which section is it?
Representative Chandler, you got an explanation.
I mean, traditionally, obviously, most committee
to the title of
most second committee referrals are the finances, always means, but some other committees do get them. But it's like any standing committee, if the speaker rules a bill that goes to finance, the committee chairman can go to the chairman of finance and. I was talking about taking it, I guess, to be basic, and just say, look, here's what the bill does. And many times the chairman of finance would agree, yeah, we don't need to see this, and that can happen, which is why that's...
So it would be the second chair.
Yes, that's intended to be the second committee of referral.
Madam Clerk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry, Representative Tucker, I couldn't find that because I wasn't looking at the title. We never used to put the titles. Last session, titles came on each of the rules, but prior to that, I was not used to seeing that on the page, and I'm still not used to seeing that. I was looking for a section of the rule, because that's not really the title.
Question answered.
Thank you.
Representative Weber.
If you read the rule, section F said, the chairman of committees receiving a bill of referral as outlined in this rule with the approval of the speaker, with the approval of the speaker, may decline the referral of any bill from another committee or notwithstanding the waiving of public hearing.
Thank you. So,
Mr.
President, good question. I thank you, Governor Biden, for the response to that question. The next section.
Thank you. The next change is on page 24, having to do with weapons. And just, I'm sure that the members of the committee are aware of this, but this section relates only to the House chamber, the ante rooms, the cloak rooms, or any portion of the State House adjacent to any of the above. It does not apply to the legislative office building or other areas of the premises that are under the control of the Senate jointly with the House. So this relates to the House chamber, ante rooms, cloak rooms, and of course the State House adjacent there too. This change would revert to the rule that was in effect from, I believe, the 1980s until, Representative Eaton correctly says the 1960s, but it's been in effect for many, many years until 2 years ago, when the rule was changed to allow the display of deadly, that prevented the display of weapons, but allowed them to be carried. And this would revert to saying that no person other than law enforcement shall carry or have in their possession a deadly weapon in any of the areas where I've just talked about. And it deletes a phrase that was added, I believe, 2 years ago, saying that a person is allowed to exercise self-defense as the defense of others. saying the rule would not preclude that. So the change is to revert back to what we had from either the 1960s or 1980s until 2 years ago.
Any comments, Mr. Chairman?
Thank you. I have two issues to this. The first being somewhat, I guess you'd call it a philosophical issue, which I will address first, and secondly, just some factual problems with it. And I said, philosophically, the problem I have with this, and I mean, obviously this is a terrible time to talk about guns from any side. I understand that in light of what's happened, but I wish we didn't even have to have this discussion now, but we're here. So the fact of the matter is, by passing, adopting this rule as proposed, without security measures in the Statehouse, which I don't think any of us have ever supported and probably won't for some period of time, without security measures, what we're doing is saying we as members will basically allow members of the public to come in, of which we will have no way of knowing that they have a firearm, but we are under more scrutiny for not being able to have a firearm and protect ourselves. And that's just a concern I have, and protect others that might be in the Statehouse. I think this doesn't stop any problem, and it might even create more problems, in my opinion. But the problem is, I think it's just, in my opinion, a knee-jerk reaction to issues as they've one happened and were perceived to have happened. So, having said that, then I also have just a couple things in my little lines on number that, and I realize these were part of the previous rule, and I have the problems that too. But any portion of the Statehouse where it mentions adjacent to above. I have no idea. Are you gonna? I mean, and I don't mean this to be facetious, but are we gonna paint a line outside? What? Because you're subjecting people to arrest, which I will get to in a minute. But when we say adjacent, what is that? I mean, everyone has a different interpretation of what could be adjacent. I don't know. The other thing is, when we are subject to disciplinary action or arrest, what?
I'm willing to hear feedback on that one right there, if that's okay. Weber, I didn't see the hand.
Because if I'm wrong.
Go Representative Weber.
I believe it says subject to ejection, not arrest.
Well, the sentence before says
disciplinary
adjacent, and it refers to adjacent, which I think is ambiguous, and then the next line, is subject to arrest, but under what? There's a statute that is mentioned. I don't know what is there. What's the penalty? I don't know. That's something that needs to be touched on. And then, the last sentence, last sentence on the page, or that any person is precluded the legally permitted exercise of self-defense or defense of others. It doesn't mention anything about firearms or guns or anything else in there. So I interpret that to mean that even if someone attacks me, I can't even defend myself with my fist. Not that I'd be able to very well. Or if I see someone attacking someone else, I can't go to their defense without any weapon or anything. And I'm not sure that's what we are intending, but it seems like that's what we have intended. So those are my concerns.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to say a couple things. First of all, just so it's clear, this revision was not a reflection of anything that happened just recently in the news. This has been underway for some period of time, so I just don't want anybody to think it's a knee-jerk reaction to that. All of us have very strong feelings about that tragedy and how horrible it was, and so I just want to clear that had nothing to do with this language. What has been proposed here is exactly what was in effect until 2 years ago, and it was intentionally done that way because we just wanted to say, look, we're just going to go back to what it was. I would say personally, and I know we have many people here, and in this room have strong feelings about this. I'm a gun owner, I have a permit to carry, but I do not believe that it is appropriate for people to be in a gallery with weapons and fourth grade students. And I think the appropriate thing for us to do today is, I believe, to go back to what the rule has been for the last 20 years. And then if there's further refinements that need to be made, that's fine. And the representative from Bartlett makes some good points, and those can be looked at. But I think for purposes of right now and getting us off on the right foot, starting a new session, we should go back to the, rules that we lived with for many years successfully.
Representative.
The amendment to Rule 63 is taking us back to where we had operated for the last 50 some odd years. It is referred to as the Marshall Cobley rule, when someone in the chamber had threatened to shoot Speaker of the House Cobley, who was unsure what to do. We did not have protective services. We did not have state police in the building as we do now. The only thing we had was the governor's driver, who was a trooper, who did come over to the House chamber. Fortunately, nothing happened that evening. The question was, how do they resolve that at that time? And they came up with Rule 63. The key, according to Marshall Cobley, who has written about it in his book and who I happened to regale in a bar evening, two or three times maybe, think of the story, is that no member may be searched. The only way that they could get that the ban placed was to search. As to Representative Chandler's objections on the last section, self-defense, that's deleting those words, which are almost redundant, because that would be covered by the New Hampshire Criminal Code. You always have a right to defend yourself or a third person.
Further comments?
Jasper.
I won't recover the points that Representative Chandler said. I do agree with him. But I will add some thoughts. While I'm no fan of the idea of weapons in the chamber or the gallery, the reality is we have no way of stopping that from happening. And one of my concerns with all of these type of rules, laws, or anything, is you only then keep people who probably have no criminal intent to begin with from carrying weapons in, and essentially leave the weapons to those who don't care about the rules or the law, and that should be a great concern to all of us. I think it's a well-known fact that people who do commit these type of crimes, their first preference is to commit the crime where they can have good assurance that there will be no one there to take them out. That they go into schools, they go into these places with a fair amount of certainty that they are going to be able to do what they want to do. It will take a certain amount of time for people to get there who have the guns, who will be able to take them out, so they're able to inflict the maximum amount of damage to their intended targets. And that is the sad reality of the situation. And that's why I really think that it is important for us to leave the rule as it is. And in terms of defining adjacent to, I would certainly say that the hallways and the stairwells are adjacent to, particularly in the gallery, essentially what we have done. And I agree, these rules were in place, but let's face it, if we could pass a law and never have to revisit it, the legislature would not be in session very often.
Busy clock.
That may not be a bad thing. That may not be a bad thing, but that's the reality. So to say that, well, that's the way it was for 50 years doesn't necessarily carry a lot of weight in my mind. We have to deal with the change in reality. So that really puts the whole second floor, every bit of the second floor, off limits with guns, because you can't get off the elevator without being adjacent to the house. You can't, on either end, come up the stairs. You can get on the elevators and go to the third floor, but that would, then what is adjacent there? I mean, is the hallway adjacent? There's no division from the hallway. It's a hallway all the way around. Doesn't that, in effect, then make actually the two floors of the building off limit to guns by the house rules, and That's not our authority, but that's the practical effect of doing that. And I certainly agree that we ought to have the ability to defend ourselves again and not wait for somebody to come, or if someone else in the house who is not able to defend themselves is being attacked, we should be able to do that. I'm sure most of us would, but then we're going to be in violation of the rules. This just doesn't make any sense. I don't think it made any sense 40 or 50 years ago, and we shouldn't just continue on by saying, well, that's what we always did.
Representative Tucker, too.
Yes, I did. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I appreciate it. I don't believe that we're going to be able to control the public through rules if they're going to be bringing things in. And moreover, speaking to Representative Jasper, this is a violation of the Second Amendment rights of the law-abiding citizens. The law-abiding citizens are not the ones that we're worried about. The criminal wants to come in. The criminal's going to come in and get a gun no matter what and carry it. It's the law-abiding citizens, which happen to also be our legislators, that this is going to affect. And further on that, we have in the Constitution the right of self-defense as a natural right. It's in our Constitution. I don't think we want to create another gun-free zone where violent crimes occur and are committed. Do we really want another defenseless zone created, and that being the State House of all places? And my last point, I'll get off my soapbox.
Okay, much time you need.
I really think this is kind of a feel-good bill, and it can't be enforced. Since we're not going to be searching them, I don't understand what the purpose of this would do other than make people be in violation of it if they feel they have the right to carry.
Thank you.
I'm a Second Amendment guy. I have more guns than probably most people should have, and more varieties than anybody should have. And I'm also aware of a long term where the rules were in effect, but there were certain members who carried, and there were certain members of law enforcement who were legislators who carried. The problem was, I've been a firearms instructor since 1980, and I see a member standing in the audience who is proficient in firearms, who I think would probably agree with me that those who are proficient and even have been through classes, that if you were in the House chamber trying to shoot at the gallery and you have dead-on sights, that the angle and degree of firing changes completely, and you can turn the gallery into a bloodbath and never affect the person that you're trying to get at, which would defeat the purpose to begin with, particularly if people carrying the chamber are carrying something like a 2-inch revolver, which seems to be what many carry over the years. Just going back to the original language that's been in place for 50 years would start the process, and I have been a proponent for a long time of having the protective services be authorized to carry weapons, because I know that they've all been certified by police standards and training and have gone through all that process, and that would be something that could be discussed in relatively short order and put in place in relatively short order.
Further comments, Representative Tucker.
Speaking to Representative Eaton's comments, I, as a representative, would feel more safe sitting in my seat if someone from the gallery were to, say, open fire on us, knowing full well that someone sitting next to me is armed. Not only is that person, probably a good dozen or so around the house is aiming back at him.
Further comments?
Well, I just got to say that gallery is full of fourth graders, and I just have to disagree with you. If you're thinking about somebody from the floor of the house shooting at somebody in the gallery, I think we've got a good reason not to allow guns in the stadium.
So, Tom, thank you very much.
It's during a tennis match. Yes.
I would feel that if the one person up in the gallery carrying a gun sees that there is 20 people on the house floor looking back at him through down the scope of their gun, it might dissuade him from shooting.
Representative Jasper.
I just want to speak to the fact that this is all about somebody shooting from the gallery. The assumption is that someone would only shoot from the gallery or attack a member in the State House from the gallery. I think that's a false assumption, although I certainly share some of those concerns, but would hope that nothing like that would happen because of the fact that people would know this is not a place where you want to come in and try to take people out. But there's also people coming in the back door, people coming in the side doors, through the anteroom. There's not only one possibility of people attacking the house, so I would hope that we would not try to use the idea of people in the gallery or fourth graders as a reason, because I think the people who are proficient in firearms would recognize that, in fact, if they were to just randomly shoot back with those kind of potential innocent victims in the way, they would not do so. But again, I think we preclude this from happening when people know that this is not a, we are not just sitting ducks on the floor of the house.
Representative Chandler, then Representative Tucker.
No,
Representative.
It might be something that Representative Chandler would like to join. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If we take this out and all members comply, what is our form of defense in the House? Should we have a situation such as that?
Representative Chandler. For
comment,
yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My mother thought I could count, so I can count here, there's no question. But having said that, I get back to which I think are problematic, is the word adjacent and the word arrest. And, is there any thought to trying to fix that either now or sometime? Because adjacent, I mean, it's in addition to a couple of things that Representative Jasper mentioned, adjacent are areas that we don't control as part of the house on the second floor. They're not house-controlled areas always. And when you go, where does the Senate, when you leave the house down on the floor towards the Senate, where does the house stop? I just think that's if we're going to arrest someone for something, we better be pretty clear where we're going to arrest them. And the other thing is the arrest thing is under what rule of law, what is that?
I believe that the rest of the complex is under the control of the Joint Facilities Committee, so I would assume they may want to address this issue as well, and that might clear up the question or make the issue of unnecessary to deal.
But and that may happen, but it hasn't happened.
Representative Weber.
I just wanted to speak to the issue of arrest because I've now managed to read all the way through the whole sentence, which I hadn't the first time I commented. But it says, and disciplinary action or arrest or both by action of the House. So the House has to do that. That's not just any old person. And that would be an action of the whole House.
I understand that. I read that, but what are they being? What is the charge? What's the penalty? What the House arrests me? Okay. What happens then? Where do I go to court? Do I face? I don't know. I don't know what the remedy is to the arrest. That's all.
I
don't know. And I'm not making light of that because I think it's serious.
I think we've probably gone beyond the point where we're changing anybody's mind on anything. But I do believe the Constitution does talk about the powers of the House to govern its own procedures, and I believe arrest is referred to in the Constitution. So I don't think it's ever been exercised in our lifetimes. But,
I'm just looking at a way to maybe clean up the language, and I'm looking at when you keep sticking upon any portion of the State House adjacent to any of the above, why can't you take that part out and insert what we mean the gallery?
Well, I think, just speaking to that, I think Representative Richardson raised a good point that maybe that's something they should probably be addressed by the Joint Facilities Committee to set the boundaries, and I'm sure that the Senate President would be glad to. I'm sure that at some point that could be taken up to joint facilities.
I believe the House Chamber includes the gallery.
The gallery does come into the House Chamber. So that's, any further comments? Representative Jasper.
I would like to offer an amendment, and I reckon it's not going to be about guns, because I recognize that that will probably be illegal. But after it says, right to stop and search any member on the House premise, on the premises of the House, to remove the period and then put back the word, or that any person is precluded legally permitted exercise of self-defense or defense of others, period.
And that's your motion?
That is my amendment to add that, those words back in.
Is there a second for the representative motion? Representative Seconds. Representative Jasper.
And just briefly, this doesn't have anything to do with guns, and it's merely stating, which should be always the case, anywhere in the state of New Hampshire, that a person has the right to self-defense, and that a person is also permitted to come to the defense of someone who may be under attack. I can't imagine how anyone would be would object to that. Yes, we have security, but sometimes attack can very quickly turn into something that results in the death of another. You don't have time to wait for someone else to come there. We need to be able to defend ourselves and each other.
Thank you. Is there a motion? I'll second it. I think Representative Tucker has already seconded it there. Is there any further comment on Representative Jasper's motion? All those in favor of the motion, please raise their right hand. Those opposed? Let the record reflect that Representative Jasper's motion passed on voting 10 to nothing. Is there a motion on this section as amended by Representative Jasper? So moved. Is there a second to adopting this section? Representative Webber seconds. Is there any comment before or opposed speaking? Seeing none, those in favor of the adoption of this section as amended.
Why can't we comment?
Please raise their right hand. Representative Jasper, okay.
I voted for your motion.
I appreciate that.
I thought that might have been. Those opposed. The motion carries on vote is 6-4.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. The next change is on page 25, talking